Welcome to the channel. Today we're going to take a look at the faction rules, how to create a kill team for Kill Team Warhammer 40k. And just a reminder, this game goes up for pre-order on Saturday. It's a skirmish game. You're going to be playing with less than 20 models, probably less than 10 models. And all the models that you're playing with will be the smallest ones from your codex. These are troops or very small things, drones, stuff like that. There's no Terminators in here, Hive Tyrants or Crisis Suits, anything like that. Open play, simply choose a kill team from the models available to you using the data sheets included in this book and other kill team products. Then in match play and narrative play, you create a command roster. Your kill team must be battle forged and consist of at least three models, no more than 20 models. Your kill team must include one and only one leader. Your kill team can include up to three specialists. As we see here, there's a zealot, scout, and communication specialist. You can't include more than the maximum of any particular model as detailed on the data sheet. All models must share a faction keyword, and your kill team cannot cost more than 100 points, which includes the model and pieces of war gear, which has associated points cost as detailed in the points in the faction sections. So that's 100 points, no more than 20 models, and it suggests that you forge a narrative. And so you'll see up here it's got mission, background, squad quirk, which you can roll for. And as far as I can tell, the mission, background, and squad quirk doesn't affect the way the faction plays at all. It's just a way of adding a narrative. So let's go to the Skitarii, the Mechanicus thing, and see what that means. Here's the Ad Mech background section. You go to their background designation, you roll a dice, so you get a six. Radzone Core. Radzone Core warriors whose way of war bathes the battlefield in purifying radiation. This kill team seeks to fashion a promised land in which only true servants of the Omnissiah can endure. And that's it, it doesn't have any gameplay mechanics. You've got the same for a mission function, you've got the same for squad quirks. Here's the data sheets, and if you pick a specialist, as you can see down here, bottom right, it has a demeanor. Then you roll a d10 and pick a specialist demeanor. Remember, you can have up to three of these guys. And then there's a random name generator on every single one of these pages. One for guard, one for death guard, one for eldar. So if you want to randomly generate a name for them, you can use this name generator. Or you can just give them names like Kevin, Bob, and Stuart. Adeptus Mechanicus has access to Canticles of the Omnissiah. Guardsmen have access to orders, all the typical things that you would expect to find from a codex, all the typical buffs are here. They have their specific command points. These are stratagems that you can play. And then these are the four faction data sheets that you can get for Adeptus Mechanicus, so Rangers, Vanguards, Rustalkers, and Infiltrators. Now, remember, I said you can bring up to three specialists. Well, the number of specialists, the type of specialists that you can have will be restricted. So, Sakaar and Infiltrators, you can see specialists along the bottom. You can pick your leader specialist, remember, one leader per kill team, or a combat, comms, scout, veteran, or zealot specialist. There are more specialisms than that. But these would be the only specialisms available to Sakaar and Infiltrators. In fact, those are the only specialisms available to all of the Ad Mech. Specialists, up to three of them. Here's the sniper specialist breakdown. If you're playing match play, you're going to be playing specialist level one all the time. If you do a campaign or narrative play or link your games together, then your specialists can gain experience. And as they go up the experience tree, they can get to level 2, level 3, and level 4 and get better and better at what they do. So here we have experience running along the bottom of this data card here. For every game that you complete, if he's still alive at the end, you're going to get some experiences, and you roll a d10 as well, and there's a potential to get more than one experience as you complete every particular game, so long as he's not dead. When you get to an orange one, he'll go to level 2. When he gets to an orange one, he or she will go to level 3. When you get 10 experience, they'll become a level 4 specialist. You need to play a campaign, you need to link stuff together, and this book is all over about linking campaigns and basically playing two or three or four games in one sitting, potentially, and linking them all together and upgrading your kill team as they go, giving them experience and experiences, and making them more beef, making them more effective on the battlefield. What does this mean? Well, it means after picking my kill team and giving one of my rangers a plasma caliber, I could make him a sniper specialist for free. And he becomes a marksman and he rerolls hit rolls of one for this model when it makes a shooting attack. All it'll cost me is the cost of the ranger and the plasma caliber. It doesn't cost anything extra to make him reroll hit rolls of one. And then he also gets access to this particular stratagem here, which will cost a command point a turn. They don't cost any more, your specialists, until they start going up levels. So when it becomes a level two, my plasma caliber wielding ranger will cost plus 4 points. When it becomes level three, plus 8 points. When it becomes level four, plus 12 points. They get more expensive as they gain levels if you're playing a campaign. And as I said at the very start, this book is geared up to playing campaigns with these guys. If you're painting up a kill team and assembling it together, why wouldn't you play another game and another game and another game and give these guys experience and let them level up and see how they get on bringing death and destruction to the enemies of man? Or the other way around, bringing death and destruction to man? Leader specialists. So you have to have a leader in your kill team. At the start of every game round, you get a command point to spend on stratagem. So long as your leader's around, you get an additional command point. So you get two command points a turn, every turn, as long as your leader is around. Those command points rack up. So if you don't spend any in turn one, you'll have four to spend in turn two. Then there's combat specialists, comms specialists, demolition specialists, heavy specialists. Almost everyone's got access to heavy specialists. These are the guys with missile launchers and things like that. Medic specialists, scout specialists, sniper specialists, veteran specialists, zealot specialists, madmen charging forward. Basically, when these guys charge, they add one attack and strength characteristics when they charge. So that's it for specialists. You have to have a leader. He gets you extra command points to spend on stratagems. You can pick up to three more specialists, but why wouldn't you? It doesn't cost you any more points apart from the guns that you stick on them, but you're sticking on guns on them anyway. And when you start playing, or if you're just playing pickup games with match play, you're always going to be level one. But when you're playing with your mates at home, you're going to be ranking these guys up, just as shown on this example command roster here, with some of them level two experience, which means they're a bit beefier in what they do. And as they become beefer, it'll cost more points to field them. You've got 100 points to spend, however. So your command roster will change and will flex around if you play a campaign. They also suggest that stick to the 100 point limit and then agree with you and your opponent, say after battle five, the fifth battle you've played, or the fourth battle you've played, you might want to change your command roster so both teams can include 150 points. That's if you're doing a campaign. You're going to be doing a campaign. Right, let's take a look at these factions. So I'm not going to be doing this for every page because Games Workshop will tell me off, but here's your missions, your backgrounds, and your squad quirks, random generator, just to add some narrative to your Adeptus Astartes forces. Like I say, I can't see how these have any gameplay significance. Here is a random name generator for Space Wolves and Dark Angels and Salamanders. Here's the specialist Deminas, which again don't appear to have any gameplay mechanic. Here's the Adeptus Astartes specific stratagems that you can use. There's general stratagems for everyone. Here's specific stratagems. And this is all of the data sheets that are available for Space Marines. You're allowed Scouts, Tactical Marines, Intercessors, and Reavers, and that's it. So as you can see, this Tactical Marine data sheet is not exactly the same as the one in the Codex. For a start, there are three different types of Tactical Marines, and the abilities are slightly different. And they shall know no fear. You can re-roll failed nerve tests for this model. Transhuman physiology. Ignore the penalty to this model's hit rolls from one flesh wound it has suffered. You can see the available specialists. You can have a leader from the sergeant, heavy gunner, comms, demolition, sniper, and veteran. Those are the specialists that are available to you. So tactical marines are slightly different, and their abilities are slightly different to average 40k, average normal 40k. Flipping over the page, we see what the damage output of the weapons is, and melee weapons, range weapons, and we can see some points values here for the marines and for the guns. For example, taking bolt rifles and bolt pistols and things like that cost 0 points, so you just, you know, but plasma guns will cost you more points. Now, these weapon characteristics, as I flick through the book, 90% of them are exactly the same as in Standard 40K, but some of them are slightly different. So, for example, plasma guns, it doesn't say if you get a plasma gun, roll a one when you're shooting with a plasma gun, it takes you out of action straight away. You don't roll on the casualty table to find out whether they've got a flesh wound or not. Where is it? Supercharged. An unmodified roll of one, the bearer is taken out of action after all this weapon shots have been resolved. It's very simple, very straightforward, similar to Warhammer 40K, but not exactly the same as Warhammer 40K. So you need to bear that in mind when you're building your kill team. Look at what your units can do and if they can do anything differently, and look at the guns and see what they can do and if they do anything differently. Like I said, 90% of it is exactly the same, but there's those little tweaks that are going to catch you out when you first start playing the game. So if you're bringing Space Marines and you're not playing an open play mission, then everything must have the Adeptus Astartes keyword, and these are your choices at the moment. These are the data sheets at the moment. I'm saying at the moment because the core rule mentions other kill team supplements, and so I'm assuming there will be other kill team supplements coming out in the future, which allows you to expand on your kill team. And I look forward to seeing those expansions in the future because I want to bring along a captain or a jumpy dude jumping around all over the place doing stuff. It'd be awesome to bring in some of the bigger boys, but I guess that's not the point of kill team. The kill team is about having elite troops, operatives behind enemy lines sabotaging stuff and getting up to all sorts of shenanigans. Kill team is about getting a squad of 10 guys together and converting them and modeling them so that they look like pure specialists. Kill team is about, I don't know, the Dirty Dozen, or it's about the squad that goes to save Private Ryan, or it's about the squad that goes into the jungle hunting for the Predator. That's what kill team is about. So I figure that's why they've given us these core, stripped down choices to get us going, to get us started in kill team. And I'm assuming that there's going to be some more choices coming in the future. But this is the core of kill team. This is what the flavor's about. This is the conversion opportunities. These are the stories, these heroes going off and doing heroic stuff. Right, let's jump into the other factions. Death Watch, you have access to Death Watch veterans. That's it. One data sheet. There are Black Shields and Watch Sergeants in there, and you still have access to specialist ammunition, but one data sheet. Grey Knights have one data sheet as well. A Grey Knight in power armor, no Terminator choices. This guy is a Psyker though. The only power you'll be able to manifest is a Psybolt power, which is like Smite, but it does one mortal wound instead of D3 mortal wounds. And as Psykers are extremely rare in kill team, he's going to be a bit pokey. The Guard have Infantry Guardsmen, Special Weapon Guardsmen, and Scions or Scions. They still have access to orders. It was AdMech next, but we've already seen them. So Heretic Astartes, you can take Chaos Space Marines, that's one data sheet, or Chaos Cultists, that's the other data sheet. Death to the False Emperor is still a thing, Chaos Icons are still a thing, and there is a stratagem, Veterans of the Long War. The Death Guard of Plague Marines and Poxwalkers, and yes, disgustingly resilient, is still in there as well. Thousand Sons have two data sheets, Rubric Marines and Zangors, and yes, Rubric Marines are Psykers, they only know the Psybolt, psychic power. Azayani have four data sheets, Defenders, Storm Guardians, Rangers, and Dire Avengers. Drukhari can bring Witches and Warriors. Harlequins are like Grey Knights and Death Watch, you can just bring players. Necrons have data sheets for Necron Warriors, Immortals, Flayed Ones, and Deathmarks. And because Games Workshop hates Xenos races, that's sarcasm, Orcs, Tau, and Tyranids have the highest number of data sheets available. They all have five. Orc Boy, Gretchen, Commando, Burner Boy, Looter. Tau have Fire Warriors, Pathfinders, Breachers, Stealth, Battle Suits, and Drones. Lots of drones. They've got all the drones, and Savior Protocols is still a thing. And if you want to go on a bug hunt, you've got Termagants, Hormagaunts, Lictors, Tyranid Warriors, and Gene Stealers. And Gene Stealer cults have Acolyte Hybrids, Neophyte Hybrids, Aberrants, and Hybrid Metamorphs. That's their four data sheets. So, annoyingly, there isn't Inquisitors in here. No way to make an Inquisitorial kill team, which would be awesome. Imagine getting the Eisenhorn model and getting together his full kill team. That would be awesome. Or gaunts and some ghosts charging off to try and take on some gene stealers. That would be awesome. But as I said earlier, I'm sure those things are coming in the future. This game is set up tailor-made for those kind of expansions, and I look forward to their release. So that's how the factions work. And at the back of the book, we've got 4 pages on playing kill team campaigns. You're going to want to play kill team campaigns. And the way it works is they recommend giving each of your factions 8 points of resource. So 8 intelligence, 8 material, 8 morale, and 8 territory. You can give them different amounts if you want to. And then you fight the narrative play games, you fight the match play games. All the narrative play games in this rule book are attack and defend missions. You pick who's the attacker, who's the defender. Match play missions aren't attack and defend. Off you go, do your thing. And then the victor of the campaigns doesn't win anything, but if you lose each of those missions, if you lose a narrative play mission, you're going to lose some resources, some intelligence, material, morale, or territory. If you lose a match play mission, you're going to lose some of these things. Whoever gets down to 0 points in one of them will lose the campaign. It's as simple as that. You can add new models as you go. This page is about adding new models as you go. You experience, you rank up your guys as they go. So if your kill team has been reduced in number, you can chuck some new people into it. You can agree to get the points up to 150 points if you want to, as you go, as the campaign progresses. If both of you are reduced to 0 points in one of these things at the end of a game, then you play a sudden death. You play a sudden death mission, and the winner of that will win the campaign. I thought the campaign missions were very straightforward, and the way the experience racks up are very straightforward. Basically, at the end of every game, you get a point of experience for all your fire team, you get a point of experience for all your specialists, and there's ways of earning more than 1 point of experience as you crack on. And essentially, you're trying to win as many points as you can, winning as many games as you can to strip away the resources of the other kill teams. You've got some spare sheets in the back, you've got a handy data sheet, reference sheet at the back, and that's pretty much it for the book over the course of the 3 videos that I've just pumped out. It's a meaty tome, there's a lot of reading here, and it's very interesting. Like I said, one of the things that surprised me was the choices of the data sheets that you could get at the very start. There aren't any captains or lieutenants or crisis suits in here. And I guess that's because they're trying to stick with the narrative, stick with the theme of what a kill team actually is. You don't get a captain of the Astartes going off behind enemy lines with a single group of stuff, a single group of tactical marines. In most cases, it does happen in the books from time to time, but in most cases, that's not how they deploy. A captain will deploy in charge of a battle company or a demi company. They won't just deploy with 10 guys. A hive tyrant won't just go charging up for 3 gene stealers and a couple of termagants. That's not how 40k functions typically. Of course, there's exceptions in every single one of the books that, and I'm sure I'll get loads of comments saying, well, what about this? What about this? What about this? I'm sure those expansions will be coming in the future. But for now, Kill Team is a very much stripped down version of Kill Team with some very interesting terrain that you can play with, some very interesting rules, and it's designed to play quickly. I like it, and I look forward to playing my first games. Anyway, that's it for these section of videos. Thank you for listening. Happy wargaming.